Customs and Border Protection wanted to purchase some of Volkswagens for, let's say, its GFK office. Does it need to pay duties? No, because it's a federal government. So, here's the duality. And states have to pay, do cities have to pay duties, like New York City? Yeah. NYPD would have to pay duties. Sheriff's office would have to pay duties. Would Secret Service have to pay duties? It's federal. So states are just like us. They are not exempt from duties. Merchandise not ordered by the importer. So this goes back, I'm going to the page 4 now. So this deals with the stuff that, I don't know, maybe you had seen those rare cases where you ordered something and you put the wrong address and stuff arrives to someone else. Or someone ordered it and you get something which you never ordered. Or even you order it, but the supplier screwed up, and instead of a Barbie doll, they send you G.I. Joe soldier, right? So you kind of have to, what do you do? You say, I want a G.I. Joe soldier. I don't want that Barbie. So you refuse the shipment. Are you liable for that shipment? Let's say you have 15 days, as we shall see, to bring the merchandise in. What if you don't do anything? Are you liable for this? No, you order Barbies. I mean, sorry, G.I. Joes, not Barbies. Just as an example. So, if the stuff, this is the provision deals with the innocent person who got entangled into the transaction which he did not want to be a part of or was incorrectly made part of, should not be punished for duties just because someone else screwed up. That's what it says. And the next one is quite important because it deals with liabilities on duties on reimportation. Page 4. Take a look. The general rule says every time you bring something in, and then bring it out, and then bring it back in again, you have to pay duties. So, dutiable merchandise, let's say this is a marker, right? 4% duty, we established before. I take it out to Mexico, I come bring it back in, take it out to Mexico, bring it back in. Without more, I'm paying 4% each time, each round trip. And of course, this rule is eaten up by exception. So, first one, is personal household effect. This is my personal pen. I'm not using it in commerce. So I don't pay duties for that. Professional books, instruments, tools of trade. So I am going on a trade show to Mexico and I bring my PowerPoint slides. So my, let's say I bring my projector. It's not my projector, but let's pretend it is. It's my tool of trade. I'm making a presentation, so it's duty-free. Automobiles, cars. If I'm taking a vacation, I put my car, I jump in my car, I go to Canada, I'm coming back, am I paying duty? No, they check your passport and let you go. How? Well, 141.2 has an exception carve-out. This is why they can do it. Substantial outer container exported from Mexico, from US, empty and returned. Well, that's pretty much what you see is what you get. You need some kind of conveniences in order to facilitate trade, so it wouldn't be very fair to make those conveniences dutiable, because they are not used as quote-unquote usual containers. They're just made merely to facilitate trade. Then we have repairs or alterations. Keep in mind, there is also, if I want to repair a watch, let's say, and I my watch broke down, so I export it to Mexico to repair it. It may be different, or maybe the next question may be, is it pursuant to warranty or not? So sometimes repairs and alterations do qualify for duty-free treatment. But in Canada, if I recall correctly, if you do not have a warranty, then it's not applicable. It must be pursuant to warranty. In Mexico, I don't think it's relevant. So, but this is a bullet point as kind of heads up to you that repairs or alterations can be an exception. Exhibition, so like a trade show. Domestic animals, highlight 8 month timeline. Domestic animals are considered to be a property, and the duty can be laid upon them. Then there is a foreign manufacturer list. I don't see that often. And chapter 98. So keep in mind, especially when you do the homework, that chapter 98, whenever you have some kind of special duty or duty-free provision, you have to also think about chapter 98 HTSUS, because chapter 98 provides mostly 8-digit numbers which you must associate with a product depending on the type of usage. So if you export something for the repairs or alterations, you use for watches, you use the watch classification plus you use the alteration or repair classification. So you use actually two HTS numbers to tell customs that this is a type of activity for which it has been exported and returned or imported pursuant to the special provision. And it may become relevant because customs may ask you a question saying, well, which special provision applies, special duty provision applies to this product? And then they give you a bunch of facts. And an answer to it, you are told a bunch of regular numbers, and then somewhere in the middle you have a chapter 98. And then you are being asked to choose. Well, this is the easy answer, because what will happen is you see chapter 98, you can just pick that right away, because that one is easy. It's easy, you can see, it's chapter 98, special duty, you don't need to look any further, pick it and move on. I don't think I gave it to you in this practice quiz. I dealt with it. I think it's scheduled for the future ones. Next, entry of merchandise. So this is a general rule. If it's a merchandise, it must be import. If it's an import, it must be entered. And we already talked about what entry means. It's a declaration, the act of delivering documents to customs. And remember, we talked about corpses as an exception. We already talked about, I think it was a day one, some of the stuff are not required to be entered. And how do you know which stuff are not required to be entered? You reference, well, you can reference to this outline, but there is a general note 3E, which lists all the exceptions, and this is in HTSUS general note 3, HTSUS, at the very beginning, which lists all the exceptions. So, exception, there is a long list of exceptions. I mentioned them several times throughout our journey. So besides obvious ones like corpses with flowers and telecom transmissions, you need to be aware that sometimes while we have engineering work, I think, Yes, so third bullet point, records, diagrams, and other data with regards to any business engineering. While a diagram and engineering data itself is not classified, it goes on the some kind of medium. That medium is classified as a printed matter. As an example, I think it was in my HTS US classification outline. Let me see if I can pull that one out. So, chapter 49 usually covers printed matter. So, if you have printed matter such as plans, drawing for architectural, engineering, industrial, commercial, or similar purposes. Well, it must be original, drawn by hand. So probably that would not be the case, because rarely anything is done by hand nowadays. But there is nothing to prevent this from being classified as other printed matter. You see international customs forms, other. So this is a default provision for printed documents. So if I was go to the bestvaluecopy.com and I am in Canada and I am ordering from bestvaluecopy.com to be shipped to Canada, they bring it to the border, I am clearing it. What would bestvaluecopy.com have to declare? HTS US? It's information, it has no duty, but it would be probably either other printed matter, because you are declaring the tangible, or this one I'm not sure, but I can also make an argument for technical or scientific or professional book. So this is a type of book that you use in your trade, right? So it's arguable, right? But so when we talk about exceptions to declarations, exception refers to the type of information but not to the tangible medium on which it is. Same thing to software, like I have a flash card. When I bring stuff into the country, I have to declare a flash card, but I don't necessarily have to declare what's on a flash card. Generally speaking, I have to say it's a software or it's a video, but I do not need to tell what type of software, what type of video. So let's go to page 6. So here's a good question. Can a non-resident consignee make an entry? We had that question before, right? But there was a question dealing with non-vessel operating carrier out of Dubai, or vessel operating carrier, steamship company out of Dubai, being able to make an entry. So a non-resident, top of page 6. A non-resident consignee has a right to make entry, but any bond taken in connection with an entry shall have a resident corporate surety. So that makes sense, right? Because otherwise, how can customs get money in case of that of the screw-up of any sort? How can it protect the revenue? Well, we have a resident insurance company, and then let them sort the mess out if there is one. When carnet issued is used as an entry form and approved resident guaranteeing association. I haven't seen that question. I'm not saying they're not existing. Anyone familiar with the concept of carnet? Heard about it? Carnet is a document which can be used instead of the entry. It is usually used. There are several types of cornice, but let's say I want to ship something to. I'm on a trade show tour, so I'm going from Germany. What's the Germany two letter code?
Frankfurt?
No, two letter code. Germany. No. Okay. Where do you look? Where is the HTSU? What's the name of it?
NXB.
NXB. So Germany. Okay, thank you. That sounds right. So Germany is D. So I am taking the product from Germany on the international trade tour to United States, and then I'm taking it to Australia, and then I'm taking it to United England. What's the code for England? We talked about that. UK. GB. GB. GB, Great Britain, and then from Great Britain I'm shipping it back to Germany. So to do this type of transaction, can you imagine me doing all this paper and requirements? It's kind of a nightmare, right? So 2 years, a bunch of countries got together and signed this treaty which allows one to use cornet. And what it does is, you apply for the cornet in Germany, and once you get to the United States, you already, cornet is already serving as insurance, so you already left your deposit in Germany, and you must get a stamp of this entry. Then once you get it out of the United States, you stamp it again with the exit stamp. Once you get to the AU, the procedure, at least in theory, should be the same. I think in the United States, to get it, you have to go to the International Chamber of Commerce or US Chamber of Commerce. I'm not sure. There is a place in Brooklyn that does it. I never done it myself, but some of my colleagues did. And they talked about procedure as going to Brooklyn, paying the fee, and it can be done in several days. So then it goes to Australia, same process, entry, exit, and same process here. And once you get to the get it back to the Germany, they check that it was entry stamp, exit stamp, and in Germany they give you the money back for the bond. If you happen to sell it at the trade show, that's a different story. We should be talking about that maybe in two classes, but then you will have to do some kind of adjustment. But that's what the cornet is. Cornet is serves as an entry, so you do not need to file an entry summary. All you need to do is just present the cornet and get a stamp. That's what it is. So do you need a surety? Not necessarily. The regulations say when cornet is used as an entry form, which it can be, an approved resident guarantee association can be used as a surety. Yeah.
Could the trade show organizer be a residential guarantee organization? I mean, just advised into a real world. I mean, for example, the thing, for the product, trade, like a trade tool, they went to America and for a trade show. But the trade show organizer, could they be approval of the residential?
So how do you get, the question is how do you get approved? How do you become approved Raising Gratian Association? I don't know. To become a corporate surety, you must apply for a license from Treasury Department, and there is a circular, I think circular 580. And you go to that circular, they provide the list of sureties, and you just call up the sureties and find out rates. For the Raising Gratian Association, I believe there is one in place like Brooklyn. How do they get approved? That's beyond the scope. So just keep in mind that Resident Guarantee Association is required, but in other cases you need to have a corporate surety. Notice a corporate surety in the first bullet point. What does that mean? That means that there are sureties that are not corporate sureties. Who can be a surety which is not corporate surety? I think it can be two people which are legal entities. No, I'm sorry, physical entities, like people like me, you guys. So long as you guys have a house. So in case there is a screw up, they can go after your house. We'll discuss that as a bond, but there is that provision, you can do that. Non-resident corporation, page 6, toward the middle. Non-resident corporation, and we've been through this, is the one which is not incorporated within customs territory of the United States or underlying Virgin Islands. If you're going to be tested, customs territory of the United States is pretty straightforward, but Virgin Islands may raise some eyebrows. And the requirement is for the non-resident corporation, if it has no presence in the United States, is to have an agent. Who would be that agent? Customs broker, in all likelihood. And as we know from the power of attorney section, the provision relating to power of attorney, where customs broker is being an agent for the non-foreign entity, non-resident corporation, the provision must there is a provision that requires customs broker to act as an agent authorized to accept service of process, and we dealt with that in the context of hypothetical where we have a Shanghai foreign entity doing business in acting as an importer of record in the United States. Next, what do you need to do? It's the first time of many that you will see CBP Form 301. This is a form that customs may just ask straightforward. Please tell what form must be used for by resident corporate surety to secure bond. CBP 301. If you get that question, it should be easy for you to answer. Toward the bottom, actual owner's declaration and superseding bond. So remember, I mentioned before that sometimes a broker or whoever became responsible somehow for whatever reason wants no longer to be responsible. How do they get relieved? Well, there is a provision 141.20 that says that you can be relieved from liability. But you must follow certain procedures. First of all, deals with the declaration. You must tell customs that you are not the actual owner of the merchandise. So let's say you transfer the title. So this is number one. You to be responsible for relief from liability, you must surrender the title to the merchandise. You must sell it or do whatever. Then you must tell customs to whom that merchandise is sold to, so they can go after that person. And this must be done within 90 days. And of course, there is a form for everything, right? So that should be done in form 3347. And of course, that new person who is a new owner must file a bond with customs again, 90-day period from the time of entry. If all those steps are taken, in other words, you cannot just release yourself from a liability. You have to take steps to transfer the liability. Kind of like have anyone received dealt with any of those camera traffic light tickets? And some people show up to court and they say, well, this is not me in the car. And what the judge would normally say, where is the person who was in the car? Show it to me, give me the documents. And unless you have that person here with you, you're still liable, okay? So same type of mentality, except in customs.